Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stung by Bethany Wiggins, narrated by Nicole Poole. Chapter 1. I don't remember going to sleep. All I remember is waking up here, a place as familiar as my own face. At least it should be. But there's a problem. The once green carpet is gray. The classical music posters lining the walls are bleached, their brittle corners curling where the tacks are missing. My first place ribbons are pale blue instead of royal. My sundresses are drained of color. And my bed. I sit on the edge of a bare, sun-bleached mattress, a mattress covered with dirt and twigs and mouse droppings. I turn my head and the room swims, faded posters wavering and swirling against grimy walls. My head fills with fuzz, and I try to remember when my room got so filthy, since I vacuum and dust it once a week. And why is the mattress bare when I change the sheets every Saturday? And where did my pillows go? My stomach growls, and I push on the concave space beneath my ribs, against the shirt sweat plastered to my skin, and try to remember the last time I ate. Easing off the bed, I stand on rubbery legs. The carpet crunches beneath my feet, and I look down. I am wearing shoes. I have been sleeping in shoes, old lady white nurse shoes, shoes that I have never seen before, that I have no memory of pulling onto my feet and tying. And I am standing in a sea of broken glass. It glitters against the filthy, faded carpet, and I can't remember what broke. A breeze stirs the stifling air, cooling my sweaty face, and the gauzy curtains that hide my bedroom window lift like tattered ghosts. Jagged remnants of glass cling to the window frame, and a certainty creeps into my brain, seeps into my bones. Something is wrong, really wrong. I need to find my mom. On legs barely able to hold my weight, I stumble across the room and to the doorway. Sunlight streams through the bedroom windows on the west side of the house, lighting the dust in the hallway. I peer into my brother's room and gasp. His dinosaur models are broken to bits and strewn across the faded carpet, along with the Star Wars action figures he's collected since he was 4 years old. I leave his doorway and walk to the next door, to my older sister's room. College textbooks are on the floor, their pages torn and scattered over the filthy carpet. The bed is gone and the mirror above the bureau is shattered. Dazed, I walk through sunlight and dust down the hall, trailing my fingers along the paint-peeling wall to Mom's room. Her room is just like the other rooms. Faded, filthy, broken windows, bare mattress, and a word I don't want to think about but force myself to admit. Abandoned. No one lives here. No one has lived here for a long while. But I remember Dad tucking me in a few nights ago, into a clean bed with crisp sheets and a pink comforter, in a room with a brand new London Symphony Orchestra poster tacked to the wall. I remember Mom checking to see that I dusted the top of my dresser. I remember Lissa leaving before sunrise for school, and Jonah's Star Wars music blaring through the house. But somehow, I am alone now, in a house where my family hasn't been in a really long time. I run to the bathroom and slam the door behind me, hoping that a splash of icy water will clear my head and wake me to a different reality, a normal reality. I turn on the water and back away from the sink. It has dead bugs and a rotting mouse in it, and nothing comes out of the rust-speckled faucet, not a single drop of water. I brace my hands on the counter and try to remember when the water stopped working. Think, I whisper, straining for the answers. Sweat trickles down my temple and I come up blank. In the cracked, dust-coated mirror, I see a reflection, and the thought of being abandoned slips away. I am not alone after all. She is tall, with long, stringy hair and gangly, like she's just had a growth spurt. She looks like my older sister, Lissa. She is Lissa, and maybe she knows what's going on. Liss? I ask, my voice scratchy dry. I turn around, but I'm alone. Turning back to the mirror, I carefully wipe away the dust with my hand. So does the reflection. My muddy eyes stare back from a hollow face. But it's not my face. I take a step away from the mirror and stare at the reflection, mesmerized and confused. I slide my hands over the contours of my lanky body. So does the reflection. The reflection is mine. I stare at myself, at my small breasts and curved hips. The last time I looked at myself in the mirror, I didn't have them. I touch my cheek and my heart starts hammering again. Something mars the back of my hand. Black, spiderish, wrong. I take a closer look. It's a tattoo, an oval with 10 legs. A mark. Conceal the mark, I whisper. The words leave my mouth without me even meaning to speak them, as if someone else put them on my tongue. Yet I know in my gut that I must obey them. I pull open the bathroom drawer and sigh with relief. Some of Lissa's makeup is in it. I take a tube of flesh-colored stuff and open it. Concealer, what Liss used to use to cover zits. I remember her putting it on in the mornings before she went to nursing classes at the University of Colorado when I was 12 and wishing I were as old as my big sister. I remember everything from back then. My sister, my parents, my twin brother Jonah. But I can't remember why I have a tattoo on my hand or why I have to hide it. I can't remember when my body stopped looking 13 and started looking like a woman's. Outside the bathroom door, the stairs groan, a sound I remember well. It means someone is coming upstairs. For a moment, I'm giddy with hope that my mom has come home. But then dread makes my heart speed up, because what if it isn't my mom? I take a wide step around the spot where the floor squeaks and tiptoe to the door. Opening it a crack, I peer through. A man is creeping up the stairs. He's wearing a tattered pair of cut-off shorts but no shirt, and his hair is long and stringy around his face. Muscles bulge in his arms, flex on his bare chest, and swell in his long legs, and thick veins pulse under his tight suntanned skin. Like an animal tracking prey, he leans down and puts his nose to the carpet. The muscles in his shoulders ripple and tense, his lips pull back from his teeth, and a guttural sound rumbles in his throat. In one swift movement, he leaps to his feet and sprints down the hall toward my bedroom, his bare feet thudding on the carpet. I have to get away, out of the house, before he finds me. I should run, now, this very second. Instead, I freeze. I press my back to the bathroom wall and hold my breath, listening. The house grows quiet, and slowly I reach for the doorknob. My fingers touch the cool metal and ease it open a hair wider. I peer out with one eye. The floor in the hall groans and my knees threaten to buckle. I am now trapped in the bathroom. I grip the doorknob, slam the bathroom door, and lock it, then yank the vanity drawer open so hard it breaks away from the cabinet. I need a weapon. My hand comes down on a metal nail file, and gripping it in my damp palm, I toss the drawer to the floor. The bathroom door shutters, and I stare at it, wondering how long before the man breaks it down. Something crashes into the door a second time. I jump as the wood splinters and scramble backward, never taking my eyes from the door. Something hits the door a third time, shaking the entire house, and I turn to the window, my only hope of escape, because there's no way a nail file is going to stop the man who is beating down the door. The window groans and fights me, the catch slipping away in my sweaty grasp. As the window grates upward, the bathroom door implodes, a spray of splinters shooting against my back. I grip the narrow window frame just like I did as a kid and swing my feet through. My hips follow, and then my shoulders. A hand thrusts through the open window, attached to a scraped, straining forearm. On the back of the hand is the twin of the symbol that marks me, an oval with 5 lines on each side. As I jump out the window, fingers slip over my neck, gouge into my cheek, and clamp down on my long, tangled hair. Fire lines my scalp as the skin pulls taut against my skull. I hang with my feet just above the balcony and flail, dangling by my hair. Somehow, the man's grip slips on my hair and my shoes touch the balcony. And then, with an unexpected release on my scalp, I'm free. I glance over my shoulder. The window frames a face with smooth skin and hollow cheeks, a boy on the brink of manhood. He peels his lips back from his teeth and growls, and I stare into his brown eyes. For a moment, it is like looking into a mirror, and I almost say his name. Until I realize his eyes are wild and feral, like an animal's. When he grips the outside of the window and swings his feet through, I scramble up onto the ledge of the balcony and jump. My spine contracts and my hips pop as I land on the trampoline my mother bought when I was 11 years old. The blue safety pads are long gone. I'm surprised the weathered black mat doesn't split beneath my feet as I bounce and come down a second time, stabbing the black mat with a nail file and dragging it as far and hard as I can. I jump over the exposed springs as my brother sails through the air behind me. The mat tears noisily beneath him and he falls through it, like jumping into a shallow pond. And when he hits the ground, I hear a snap and a grunt. I run to the fence that separates my house from the elementary school and dig my feet into the chain-link diamonds. Just like when I was a kid, racing the tardy bell, I clamber up and over the fence in a heartbeat. As I sprint across the empty schoolyard, past the silent, rusted playground, I dare a look over my shoulder. My brother is hobbling toward the fence, his ankle hanging at an odd angle to his leg. His eyes meet mine, and he holds a hand up to me, a plea to come back. A sob tears at my chest, but I look away and keep running. Chapter 2. A scorching sun beats down from the turquoise sky, gleaming off the distant buildings of downtown Denver. Yet no leaves grow on the skeletal trees, no flowers bloom in pots on front porches, no grass grows in dead front yards. Even the Rocky Mountains looming on the western horizon look brown and brittle. The only green in this world comes from brown-tinted pine trees, those that aren't as dead as everything else. I am in a world of winter being burned beneath a summer sun. I stumble through a silent neighborhood. The house's windows are shattered. Rusted cars sit atop flat tires and driveways. My shadow stretches long over the cracked, litter-strewn pavement. I skirt around a faded, tipped garbage can and walk faster, because deep down, I can sense that this is a bad place to be when the sun sets. My feet slow as I walk toward a telephone pole. The wires lie spaghetti twisted on the ground below it, and tacked to the front is a piece of paper at odds with this trashed, forgotten neighborhood. The paper is daffodil yellow, not sun-bleached or water-warped or wind-frayed. I take a closer look. Reward. 1 to 4 marks equals 1 ounce honey. 5 to 7 marks equals 2 ounces honey. 8 to 9 marks equals 3 ounces honey. 10 marks equals 8 ounces honey. To claim reward, marked one must be alive. Payments made Sundays at South Gate or North Gate. No payment for dead body. Sincerely, Governor Jacoby Sonneschen. I walk past the daffodil yellow paper and round a corner in the deserted street, and a dog barks, the first sound that I haven't made myself since leaving my house. More dogs join in, and my heart speeds up, a weak, dehydrated fluttering against my ribs. 4 houses ahead, a window reflects evening sunlight, and the window is whole. Several dogs stand in the front yard below that window, teeth bared, saliva strings dangling from their barking mouths, yanking against the chains that keep them from charging me. My steps slow, and I glance at my right hand. The flesh-colored makeup still hides the tattoo. When I look back up, 4 men stand in the yard with the dogs, and each man holds a gun pointed at me. M16 assault rifle. The name filters into my confused brain, and I can remember the day my dad taught me to shoot. The guys at the Buckley Air Force Base always saluted Dad, even though he wheeled himself up to the platform in a wheelchair, his final badge of military duty, one he could never leave home without. "This your kid?" one guy asked, looking at me where I cowered behind the wheelchair. I stared up at his camouflage clothes, his broad shoulders, and tried to imagine my dad dressed like that and standing tall. "Yeah, she's 11," Dad said. "Figured it was time to teach her to shoot." The guy nodded approval but looked skeptical. "Never too young to start him out. Just warn her about the recoil. We wouldn't want her leaving with a black eye." The rest of the time at the shooting range was a blur of guns, noise-muffling ear covers, and recoils that flung me backward. But I remember the look in my dad's eyes at the end of the lesson, and the other men's eyes. Surprise. "With the finger control you're learning in piano, you'll be a sharp shooter in no time," Dad said, his hazel eyes glowing with pride. One by one, the M16s are lowered as the men study me. I take a tentative step forward, and all four guns point at me before I can flinch. I don't move.
"Ellen, come here,"
one of the men calls, staring at me through the scope on his gun. He seems to be the oldest of the four. His hair is white, at least. The front door opens, and a thin, hard woman steps onto a front porch edged with shrub skeletons. The white-haired man nods toward me. The woman puts her hands on her bony hips and squints. "I have seen her before. She is the mother of one of my schoolmates. I used to play at this house, and this woman was always baking. She used to be as soft and round as her cookies." She presses a hand to her heart.
"Dear Lord Almighty, that's Fiona Tarsus. If she doesn't have the mark of the beast, let her pass."
Three of the four guns lower.
"Hold up your hand,"
the white-haired man calls. I lift both my hands over my head, palms facing them, a sign of surrender.
"No, your right hand,"
he says, voice hard and mistrusting.
"Show me the back of your right hand."
Of course, he wants to see my tattoo. I turn my right hand, palm facing me, tattoo facing him. Ellen sighs, the sound carrying down the quiet street.
"She's clean."
The fourth gun is lowered, but none of the men relaxed.
"Get on past here, Fiona,"
the white-haired man calls. I nod and start jogging. As I pass the house, the dogs go ballistic, jerking against the chains anchoring them in place. I stare into the front yard and study the men. But I was wrong about something. Only three are men. The fourth, the one who kept the M16 trained on me the longest, is Jackie, my old schoolmate. But there's something really wrong with her. She's on the verge of being an adult, and her thick brown hair is cut like a boy's, short as a soldier's.
"Get on by,"
the white-haired man warns. I stare straight ahead and jog as fast as my weary legs will carry me, which is not very fast. Just as I pass the edge of their property, a shadow appears beside me. I gasp and cover my head with my arms. "Foe, Fiona." It's Jackie, the older womanly version of her in spite of her boy hair. Her hands are in my hair, twisting it, shoving it down the back of my shirt. "Cut your hair off," she says, eyes scared. She presses something into my hand and retreats to her front yard. I look at what she's given me and frown, a half-eaten snack pack of crackers. The sight of them makes my parched throat clamp shut, so I stuff them into my pocket. Movement catches my eye. In the last rays of the setting sun, a child perches on the roof of Jackie's house, a gun in his small hands, his eyes darting all about. Behind a fence in Jackie's backyard, I can see the tops of corn stalks. Green corn stalks. In the midst of the corn stands Ellen, trailing a fine bristled brush over the feathery wisps that shoot out at the top of the corn, moving from plant to plant in a methodical, deliberate manner. Painting the corn. I look back up at the boy. He can't be more than 8 years old, but the way he holds the gun, he might as well have held it in the womb. He glares at me and aims in my direction. I turn and continue down the littered, deserted road. When I get far enough from Jackie's house that I can no longer see the boy, I stop. With the sun gone, the air fuses with twilight and darkness creeps in, unsettling my nerves, giving me the impression that something hides in the shadows. Something teases my ears. I pause and survey the decrepit houses haunting the street. I peer into the black, glassless windows and feel as if someone is watching me. I pray I'm imagining it. Shelter. I need to find shelter. I step over trash, over bleached human bones, over tree branches and tumbleweeds and empty plastic bottles strewn across the road. With every step, the approaching night grows darker, making it harder to see, harder to tell the difference between trash and road, harder to tell the difference between real and imagined. A dog barks behind me, and the desire to find shelter makes me frantic. I run, dodging trash, and jump over a mangled car door. When I land, my knees buckle beneath my weight. I squat on my heels and rest my hands on my knees. Panting, I lick my peeling lips, but my tongue holds no moisture. I need water almost as much as I need air, more than I need shelter. Another dog joins the first, a distant barking that echoes down the road, driving me to action. I stand unsteadily and face the silent houses. There has to be water in one of them, maybe left in a toilet tank, or forgotten in a tea kettle, or caught in the coils of a garden hose. Ignoring the instincts that warn me to stay out of the houses, I walk toward the closest one, staring at the gaping windows. I step up onto the sidewalk and pause. My skin tightens as if something is watching me, like the darkness will devour me if I take another step. More dogs start barking. A gun explodes, echoing like thunder. I turn and look down the dark road towards Jackie's house, and the gun explodes again. Raised voices fill the night, mixed with the frantic barking. Someone screams, a deep male scream, and a gun goes off again. And then there is nothing but the ringing in my ears. Something grabs my arm and I am yanked backward, tripping over trash and the curb and my own feet. I scream, but my throat is too dry to muster up anything more than a croak. "Shut up!" someone snaps, the person dragging me to the middle of the street to the black ring of an old tire. The person, a short wisp of a human, a child, releases my arm and shoves the tire away. Beneath it sits a barely visible manhole. Metal echoes hollowly as the lid is slid aside, and then the shadow launches itself into the hole in the road and disappears. I peer down into the blackness and cringe at the dead animal and raw sewage smell wafting up. A pale hand darts out of the opening and grabs my ankle.
"Hurry up and jump, or you'll be worse than dead."
The child hisses, digging ragged nails into my skin. And then I hear a new sound. Footsteps. Lots. Pounding against the pavement faster than my frantic heart pounds against my chest. Getting closer.
"Fine, stay up there, freaking idiot."
The manhole starts scraping back into place as the footsteps thump closer. I peer down the dark road toward the sound of the footsteps and see a horde of shadows approaching. Big, broad-shouldered shapes silhouetted by starlight. I swallow, step, and plummet into darkness. Chapter 3. I soar through darkness, but only for a heartbeat. My feet impact on the ground and sink, the squishy floor absorbing the jolt from my fall. It is like standing at the edge of the ocean and letting the incoming tide wash the sand over my feet until I can't pull them out without wiggling them loose. I move my feet and the ground squelches. Above me, stars shine in a sphere, a half moon, a crescent, and then there's darkness as the manhole locks back into place, the child panting with the effort of it. My feet squelch again, and the child leaps to the ground and grabs me, nails digging into my shoulder and pulling me down. Lips are on my ear, and I can't tell which smells worse, the child or the air.
"Shut up, or I'll kill you,"
it whispers. A small hand comes over my mouth, and something cold and rough slides against my throat. I swallow a spitless swallow, and my throat bobs against sharp roughness. I hardly dare breathe. Above, the hollow smack of feet echoes. The child and I stay frozen in a tense embrace, my mouth still covered by a grimy hand, the sharpness warming against my neck. The footsteps pass, but the child doesn't move a muscle. Yet the child's heart thunders against my back. We stand frozen together for a long time, until the child's heart slows. And then, without a sound, I'm released. I stumble forward, arms flailing in pitch blackness. A hand grabs my elbow before I fall, and the child starts guiding me through the darkness, over the squelching floor. The child's feet don't squelch, just mine. I hold my hands forward like I'm sleepwalking, but the child obviously knows where to go. In spite of the blackness, we walk at a steady pace. The child counts under its breath, and when it gets to a certain number, it pauses and we turn, left or right, always different. Every once in a while, starlight, slatted by the bars of a storm drain, filters down to where we creep. And every time we pass beneath a storm drain, the child clasps a grimy hand against my chapped lips. We walk a long time, silent, until the child asks,
"Why are you so clean?"
The whisper, out of place in the dark tunnels, startles me.
"What?"
I say.
"You're clean. Your clothes, your skin, and you smell like..."
It sniffs.
"Plants and iodine. Are you from the right side of the wall?"
"What wall?" I whisper.
"Shut up!"
The hand is over my mouth again. We turn a corner and blue starlight glows down from a storm drain. I walk on my toes and the squelching becomes a muted, wet squish. We pass the glow and walk for a few minutes in silence before the child speaks again.
"Are you from inside the wall?"
"What wall?" I ask a second time, my voice a whisper. Even if I wanted to speak louder, I don't know if I could. "I'm thirsty," I say, panting. We stop walking, and the child releases my arm.
"Look here, girl,"
the child growls.
"I just saved your life. You're the one who should be giving me water. You owe me, and you're going to pay me back, or I'm going to leave you here, in the dark, right now, to shrivel up and die like everything else."
The child's voice is high, feminine.
"Pay you back?"
My hand goes to my throat, tracing the dip of my collarbone, searching for a necklace. But there's nothing there. I lower my empty hand.
"How can I pay you back?" I ask. "I don't have any money or jewelry."
"Money? Jewelry? I can't eat those or trade them. Do you have any food or honey?"
"Honey. I remember honey. Gold, sweet, melted with butter on wheat toast at breakfast, drizzled in tea, made by bees. Bees are on the endangered species list." And now I can hear my sister's voice like she's standing beside me. "Since the bees are endangered, we have to plant these special flowers to help feed them." Liz dug a shallow hole in the dirt and dropped a seed inside for Jonah and me to see. "Bees love lavender, the color, the smell," she explained. "And so do I. Here, you guys plant some." She put three small pale purple seeds into my hand and three into Jonah's. Using my fingers, I dug a shallow hole in the damp soil. "What will happen if the bees go extinct?" Jonah asked, burying his first seed. "First of all, there would be no more honey. It would become the world's most rare, most precious food, even more precious than gold," Liz said. "But that's just the beginning. Bees pollinate a huge percentage of the world's crops. If bees die out, things like apples and peaches and vegetables will die. Lots of plants will die without the bees pollinating them. And if the plants start dying, then the things that eat plants will start to die, like cows and chickens, which means no more meat for us to eat. If we have no fruits or vegetables to eat and no meat, our world will experience a major famine. People will start starving to death worldwide." I looked at the tiny seeds in my hand and wondered how something so small could make a difference if the bees were already going extinct. "Don't look so scared," Liz said, patting the top of my head. "My biology teacher says that the government has their top scientists and biologists working on a solution."
"Hello? Can you pay me back now or what?"
I shake the memory from my head. No, I don't have anything to give you.
Whatever. You can pay me back with a favor. And when you complete it, then I'll give you all the water you can drink, it says.
No, I need water now. The child sighs and mutters under its breath. The sound of water swishes and my dry throat clamps tight with desire. A narrow container is pushed against my hands. I grab it, open the lid, and chug it down. But before my thirst is slaked, the water is gone, leaving sand in my teeth and the taste of copper on my tongue. The empty bottle is yanked from my hand.
I just saved your life twice now, idiot. You owe me double.
Fingers find my elbow and, clutching it a little too hard, guide me forward again. My feet squelch against the floor and my mouth is deliciously damp. I sigh, content. I'll repay you double, I say, willing to do anything for more water. Not a smart thing to do when you haven't been told the price. When we finally stop walking, fatigue drags at my body. A scritch disturbs the silence and a match sparks to life. I squint against the tiny flame and look around. I stand at the end of a tunnel surrounded on three sides by concrete. Above, pipes slowly drip water into waiting, dented pots, and above them, darkness. The child lights a candle and grabs my hand, big, hungry eyes examining the back of it.
So much for paying me back double, it grumbles, shoving my hand away.
The child, slight and bony, wears baggy clothes, a grimy shade of gray, the same color as its sickly skin. Its dark hair is short everywhere but in the front, where long greasy bangs cover most of its face, except for a pointy nose sticking out. I lean toward the child, trying to peer beneath the thick hank of hair. It sounds like a girl, is small like a girl, but there's something masculine in the way she, he, stands. Are you a boy or a girl? I ask. The child whips the bangs out of its face and grins at me with stained teeth.
Does it matter?
I stare at the child's dark, shifty eyes. I guess not. The child gnaws on its thumbnail and studies me for a moment, eyes calculating.
I'm a girl, but when things get ugly, looking like a boy is more protection than a hidden knife.
The way she says it, she sounds way more grown up than she looks.
Rest. You'll need it. You're paying me back tomorrow. Double.
A pile of blankets are heaped in a corner where the cement walls meet. I walk toward them, but the girl steps in front of me and puts her hand against my shoulder.
Sorry, Flower. That's where I sleep.
My name's not Flower, it's Foe.
Aaron, nice to meet you.
Aaron takes a blanket from the pile and chucks it at my feet.
And just so you know, Foe, if you try and ditch me while I sleep, the others will kill you, she says.
I peer over my shoulder toward the dark tunnel. Others?
Yeah, the others. You know the people who've banded together and hide down here in order to survive? They kill wanderers before they ask questions, so don't wander off if you ever want to see the sun again.
Aaron collapses onto the pile of blankets and blows out the candle. My eyes open wide and I swing my hand in front of them. I see nothing. Reaching down, I spread the blanket on the cement floor and ease onto it. And gag. The blanket smells like vomit, moldy cheese, and urine. My stomach turns and I scramble to my feet. Wadding up the blanket, I toss it away. Cold, hard cement over the smell of that? Any day. I lie on my side with my arm under my head, but I don't sleep. Not yet. Not with my body screaming for the water dripping into a pot not 3 feet away. When Aaron's breathing grows deep and methodical, I roll onto my hands and knees and stick my face into the pan. Water drips onto the back of my head as I drink, but that doesn't slow me down. I drink until my belly wants to pop. And then finally satisfied, I lie on my back. Aaron mumbles in her sleep. Something about bacon, her voice a deep grumble. I try to block her out by focusing on the rhythm of dripping water, a liquid metronome. My fingers moved the beat, tapping out the notes to the second movement of Beethoven's seventh against my thigh. And as I play the silent music, I cry myself to sleep. Chapter 4.
First thing we have to do is cut your hair.
I still hear the rhythm of water dripping onto water. Beethoven's seventh still haunts my groggy brain, keeping time with the dripping.
And then we'll make you really dirty, really filthy. You stand out, not in a good way. Sad fact about cleanliness, it makes you a minority if you're on the wrong side of the wall. Who are you anyway?
I open my tear-crusted eyes and the music in my head jolts to a stop. A glowing candle flashes against Aaron's close face. She sits cross-legged beside my head, holding a rusty dagger in one hand, tugging my hair out of the neck of my shirt with the other. I push against the cement floor and sit.
What are you doing?
I croak, staring at the knife.
Waking you up, idiot. The early bird always gets the worm, and I have a mighty big worm that needs getting.
What time is it? I wonder aloud, looking at my empty left wrist. I always wear a watch. Correction, war.
There is no time down here,
Aaron says, rubbing a strand of my hair between her thumb and finger.
So what are you doing on the wrong side of the wall?
I think about the meaning behind her words. At least I try to, but I don't know what she's talking about. You mean, what was I doing out on the street last night?
Duh,
she rolls her eyes. My brother's face wavers in my mind. A younger face, smiling, gentle. Not how he was yesterday, if that was yesterday. But there's no way I'm going to tell Aaron that I was running from my own brother.
I was running from something.
Yeah, I got that. You caught the attention of the raiders. What did you do to make them come after you?
Them?
I think of the shadows running down the street toward me just after sunset and shrug.
Nothing.
Whatever. I totally saved your butt. They never let anyone get away, especially girls. And now you've got to repay me. Double. As soon as possible, because I can't have you dependent on me for anything, including water.
She glares at the pot I drank from the night before.
And if you want to succeed in that payment, you got to look like a boy, and you got to be dirty.
She lifts the dagger and candlelight flickers against the rusty blade. I lean away and press a hand to my neck.
I'm not going to kill you, idiot. You're worth too much alive. The knife's for your hair,
she says. I grab my hair and wind it around my hand. It hangs down to my hips, longer than I remember it ever being in my life, and thicker. Aaron rolls her eyes.
Yeah, so it's glossy and smooth and the color of wheat. You'd be in a shampoo commercial if we still had television. Thing is, no one but the lice can appreciate it down here. Just hold still.
She holds the knife toward me and I flinch.
Look, foe, you'll be thanking me for getting rid of it. Trust me.
I hug my knees to my chest. The knife saws against my hair, tearing it from my scalp more than cutting it. But then I feel a release and my sheared hair falls around my shoes in a shiny, honey gold pile. Aaron takes a chunk of the hair still attached to my scalp and hacks it even shorter until she's moved around the entire back of my head. Until I imagine I look just like her. Short, uneven hair on the back and sides of my head. Chin-length hair in front that covers most of my face. Totally ugly. My mother would be mortified. The thought makes my heart ache. Where is my mother? Aaron grins, a flash of teeth as dingy as her skin.
Perfect,
she says, eyeing my hair. Her breath smells like the tunnels.
Are you rested? Because the sun is going to set in a couple of hours, and that's when you are going to pay me back. Double.
Right. My stomach growls, and I remember the half-eaten pack of crackers from Jackie. I take them from my pocket and slide one into my hand. It is a peanut butter-filled sandwich cracker, dusted with little grains of salt. My mouth waters. A black weight hits my chest, and I fly backward. The candle wavers and goes out just as my head crunches against cement. Heavy darkness sits atop me, pinning my arms to the ground, clawing the crackers from my hand.
Are you did you get these?
Erin asks, mouth full. She swallows noisily.
I haven't tasted peanut butter in 2 years.
She climbs off me. I hear the crackers crunching in her teeth.
These crackers, they can help pay off your debt to me.
Hunger stabs my hollow stomach. Not if I die of starvation first. I need food. I retort, climbing to my knees and rubbing the goose egg on the back of my head. She laughs, and I can smell peanut butter on her rancid breath. A match scrapes and a flame flickers. She relights the candle, and shadows dance against her greedy, chewing face.
Here, gnaw on this.
She tosses something at me. Relieved at the thought of eating, I snatch it out of the air and frown. A leather belt, half-eaten and covered with teeth marks, dangles from my hand. I toss it back and stare at her like she's crazy. Erin lets the belt fall to the ground and shrugs.
Suit yourself, but there ain't nothing else to eat down here.
She looks at the last cracker, golden and clean in her discolored hand, then breaks off a tiny piece, barely a morsel. She holds it out to me.
Here.
She says it like she's just sacrificed something priceless. I guess a crumb is priceless to someone who is starving, someone like me. I take it and swallow without chewing. My stomach growls for more. Erin holds the last cracker with the tips of her fingers and nibbles toward its center like a mouse, beady eyes focused on me, as if she's afraid I might fight her for it. I stare and she glares, but I don't take my eyes from her. It isn't the cracker that holds my attention. Something darkens the back of her right hand. An oval with three lines drawn through it like insect legs, two on the left, one on the right. I glance at my own hand. The edge of my mark is showing through the makeup and dirt. My palms turn icy damp and I wipe them on my shirt. I need some privacy, I blurt, touching the tube of makeup in my pocket.
Pee over there.
She nods toward the darkness, and I wander out of the ring of candlelight.
But foe, the others, don't go far.
I stumble through the darkness and come to the end of the cement. My feet sink into goo and squelch with each step. When I am sure Erin cannot see me, I slip the makeup from my pocket and dab it on the back of my hand, smoothing it over the tattoo, over the 10-legged spider. When I'm done, I squat and relieve myself. And as I am retying the drawstring waist on my knee-length shorts, a squelch echoes behind me, followed by a gasped curse. I flip around and face the black tunnel. Someone could be standing 6 inches from me, engulfed in darkness, and I wouldn't be able to see him. I turn to the flickering candle and hurry toward it, easing my feet onto the slick floor with each step, trying not to squelch. And then I am on cement, inside the glow of candlelight. Erin lounges on her nest of nasty blankets, hands behind her head, staring at the pipes on the ceiling.
Erin,
I whisper. She looks at me with heavy eyes.
Those crackers,
she says with a sigh. She grins and licks her teeth.
I think someone is in the tunnel,
I whisper, glancing over my shoulder. Her eyes snap wide and she springs to her feet, dagger in hand.
We know you're there. I'll kill you if I see you.
Erin snarls, her words ringing with violent truth. She slices the air for impact, and I take a step away from her. There is no reply. Crouching beside the candle, she blows it out. We plunge into darkness so thick I can hardly breathe it into my lungs.
Why did you blow out the candle? I ask.
So they can't see us? If they can't see us, it makes it a hell of a lot harder to kill us.
I gasp.
Stop breathing so loud,
Erin whispers.
They won't need the light to kill you if you keep making noise like that, and I'm not going to save you again.
I open my mouth and take slow, silent breaths, straining to hear the warning sound of approach. A long time passes. My legs begin to itch from standing still for so long. I sink down to the ground and sit on the grimy cement. Icy hands are on me, touching my face, wiping my arms. I pull away and whimper, expecting a knife in the back.
Hold still, idiot.
Erin breathes, I force myself to freeze beneath her hands. She keeps touching me, wiping grit onto every inch of my exposed skin. When no skin is left untouched, she whispers,
"Take off your clothes." "What? Hurry up, just take them off. We need to trade."
Fabric rustles. A warm mass is dropped into my lap. Her clothes. I pull my shirt over my head, and after taking the concealer out of the pocket, slip off my shorts, holding them in what I assume is her direction. She snatches them away.
"But first," she whispers, "you need to wrap this around your you-know-whats."
She drops something else in my lap, a long, thin strip of fabric.
"Wrap this around my what?"
I ask, baffled.
"How dense are you? Do I seriously have to spell it out?"
When I don't answer, she blurts,
"Around your knockers, foe. No one's going to believe you're a boy if they get a look at those, even if they are small. Sheesh."
She mutters under her breath as I struggle to bind my breasts, tying the fabric into a knot below my left armpit. When I'm done, I fiddle with her clothes until I find the shirt. As I pull the stiff, greasy-feeling fabric over my head, I gag. The stench is unreal. Sweat, urine, dirt, sewage. I pull on the pants, barely manage to squeeze them over my hips, and, sucking in my stomach, force them to button.
"You are so fat,"
Erin whispers, her voice filled with wonder.
"It's a good thing these shorts have a drawstring."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.